I'm Petty Officer Kathleen Booth.
And I'm Petty Officer Herb Josie. And this week on Navy Marine Corps News, the Chief of Naval Operations visits with sailors in Norfolk.
U.S. Marines team up with Australian soldiers in Exercise Golden Eagle in Hawaii.
And USS Normandy sets sail for Europe to celebrate the 50th anniversary of D-Day.
Join us along with Petty Officer Mark Kane for these stories and more on Navy Marine Corps News.
This week on Navy Marine Corps News, the Chief of Naval Operations visits sailors in Norfolk. U.S. and Australian forces train together in Hawaii. And USS Normandy sets sail for Europe to celebrate the 50th anniversary of D-Day.
I'm Petty Officer Kathleen Booth.
I'm Petty Officer Herb Josie.
And I'm Petty Officer Mark Kane. We'll have these stories and more next on Navy Marine Corps News.
Welcome to Navy Marine Corps News. Chief of Naval Operations Admiral Mike Borda continues to make headlines as a hands-on, people-oriented leader. During a recent visit to Norfolk, he took questions from the fleet in a packed auditorium filled with more than 1,200 sailors.
The CNO also met with some of the sailors in the George Washington Joint Task Group before they deployed. Here's a look at the sights and sounds of Admiral Borda's whirlwind visit to the fleet in Norfolk.
He's a real people person.
He can understand where we're coming from when we talk to him.
I think he's going to be a great CNO.
Naval operations arriving.
I came to Norfolk today for what I think are a couple of good reasons. This is the first battle group to deploy since I became a CNO a little over 3 weeks ago. And it just happens to be deploying to the place that I just left as Commander-in-Chief. I kind of felt like I ought to be part of that.
A pretty down-to-earth, normal kind of guy.
I was the designated driver, and then when I pulled up to get him, he said, "Get in the back, son, I'm driving." No, I don't argue with the CNO.
I think it's going to be a good one. First of many, okay? Thank you. Have a great deployment.
I heard he was unexpected. Yeah, he's as he's different. So he may surprise me today.
I'd like to open this up to questions. I can learn a lot on trips like this by getting questions and answering them. You get something from me when I answer them, and that's nice. But you asking the questions teaches me things that I can then go work on.
My question has to do with the single sailor that is at sea.
Do we have anything in work as far as high year tenure?
Why hasn't the evaluation process been changed, and why are we ranked?
Our Navy will be good or bad based on you, just like it's good or bad based on me. Let's go make it good. Thanks a lot.
Now, that truly is a whirlwind trip.
Ooh, he went to, I think, 11 ships in about 2 hours. He was all over the place down on the waterfront.
Well, what did the sailors think?
I think that they can relate to him really well because he's a former enlisted, and he's been in their shoes, and they understand that, and they think he understands their concerns.
Well, good. Good report, Herb. Thanks. And now Petty Officer Mark Kane joins us for a look at what's going on around the fleet. Mark?
Thanks, Kathleen. Some good news for the military. The IRS plans to issue guidance that exempts moving allowances from being taxed. We'll have more on that in coming weeks after the IRS issues the guidance. Two Navy Coastal Patrol ships have deployed to Haiti as part of Operation Support Democracy. USS Cyclone and USS Tempest, based at Little Creek Amphibious Base, Norfolk, are shallow draft ships ideally suited for interdiction operations close to the shoreline. Each ship has a platoon of Navy SEALs embarked to assist with boarding operations. This is the first operational deployment for these ships since they were commissioned. Sailors and Marines at Whidbey Island and Cherry Point have something to be proud of. They are stationed at two of the best U.S. military bases in the world.
At a Washington, D.C. ceremony sponsored by the President, an Excellence Award was presented to each of the service's top bases. Cherry Point was honored as the Marine Corps' best installation, and Whidbey Island earned recognition as the Navy's top base.
And at Whidbey, we really feel that we have a team. Active duty, reserves, civilians, and certainly our local community, the town of Oak Harbor, Washington, have formed a team that is absolutely unbeatable, a team that keeps quality of life and mission accomplishment absolutely at the forefront.
Cherry Point's commander also praised the members of his team.
These guys work 24 hours a day to make the quality of life good for the young Lance Corporal that's carrying a rifle and is out there protecting the nation.
Cherry Point is located in North Carolina and Whidbey Island in Washington State. Washington, D.C. was also the site for a ceremony recognizing African-American military pioneers.
The Golden 13, the first African-Americans to become naval officers, were honored along with the Army's Buffalo Soldiers, the Army Air Corps' Tuskegee Airmen, and the Montford Point Marines, who were the first African-Americans in the Marine Corps. Three of these men were the first black officers to wear the Corps' red and gold and have inspired many who have followed.
The ranks of the Marine Corps today are filled with sergeant majors, African-American, first sergeants, African-American, master gunnery sergeants, as I was, African-Americans. So we are very pleased that many have gone on and been inspired by these gentlemen that you've talked with here today.
There's a new policy on the streets for sailors traveling on Navy aircraft.
Sailors like these travelers are no longer required to wear their uniforms. Civilian clothes are authorized for sailors while traveling aboard military aircraft when on leave or on orders.
And finally, Secretary of the Navy John Dalton has directed a change in the word sailor. From now on, in all written correspondence, the first letter S will be capitalized, just like the M in Marines has always been capitalized. Secretary Dalton said that sailors are a special group of people whose capital contributions rate the distinction of the uppercase S. And that's a look with a capital L at this week's fleet headlines. Kathleen?
Thanks, Mark. June 6, 1944, 200,000 Allied troops invade the beaches of Normandy, France. It was Operation Overlord, better known as D-Day, and it marked the beginning of the end of World War II.
On June 6, 1994, thousands of veterans will once again hit the beaches of Normandy, but this time they'll be welcomed on the same beaches they fought on 50 years ago.
Petty Officer Dave Smith caught up with USS Normandy as it left New York and headed for the celebrations in England and France.
Allied forces landed all their troops and equipment on Normandy in only 48 hours, a feat which led to the liberation of Europe. In honor of this historic event, an Aegis-class cruiser was named after the invasion.
Well, this is just probably the single biggest honor I've ever had in my life. USS Normandy is the only U.S. Navy ship ever named for the world's most famous battle, and it's wonderful actually being on center stage here. I couldn't imagine a better job in the Navy.
As the crew prepared to get underway, nine enthusiastic World War II veterans, some who were actually at Normandy on D-Day, came aboard.
Oh, when I found out about Normandy, I got so excited to think that I was there 50 years ago, and here I'm going now. I want to go to Utah Beach just to put my foot on there and look and reminisce and say, gee, that was here, you know? Everything will go through my mind and my heart.
I'm very excited since the moment I was told that I would be going with him. Relive all his experiences.
I feel that the day that we reach Normandy, it'll be maybe the second most important day of my life. I believe that the day that on D-Day was the most important day of my life.
With the World War II vets aboard, the Navy, Marine Corps, Army, and Merchant Marines were represented. With so much combat experience around, crew members are expecting to hear loads of sea stories.
I think the younger guys will really get a kick out of talking to these gentlemen. They've been through experiences that we can't even come close to.
I used to study world history, and the World War II period was my favorite part of history. My main thing is to get sea stories from them.
I mean, I wasn't born then when all that went on, so it'll be like a learning experience for me.
It will probably be a learning experience for the veterans as well, since shipboard technology has advanced since their day. But one World War II vet summed up the real purpose of this commemoration.
And if we don't heed the lessons of history, we're doomed to repeat them. And I think the emotional aspect of this trip is going to be phenomenal, without a doubt.
From Staten Island, New York, I'm Petty Officer Dave Smith.
Later in the show, we'll go for a ride on the SS Jeremiah O'Brien, the only remaining active World War II Liberty ship.
And up next, UN troops in Croatia learn how to deal with the Devil's Sea. Stay with us.
Oh, every time we say goodbye.
Goodbyes are never easy, but none are as painful as saying goodbye forever. So please, give blood once more this year. You could help save someone you never want to part with.
I wonder why a little.
Welcome back to Navy Marine Corps News. Sailors operating with the UN in Croatia work in an extremely hostile environment. While enemy shelling is a dangerous threat from above, there's an unseen enemy that threatens troops from below. Petty Officer Bill Polson reports from Zagreb, Croatia.
The American hospital at Camp Plaso often reaps the grim harvest of what has been called the Devil's Seed, better known as landmines. Everywhere war's gone in the former Yugoslavia, it spread the suffering from these buried explosives, as those who work here know all too well.
This is the wound we have. That sounded louder than what we usually hear around here.
That was the detonation of a landmine about 300 yards away from this unit that's already treated 10 landmine victims lately. Even the smallest mines, which carry a charge of about 6 to 10 grams of plastic explosive, produces devastating results.
One of our patients had both legs blown off. Another patient had one leg blown off and the other leg badly damaged. A third patient had his entire sacrum, his bottom, and his left hip blown off. A number of the others had shrapnel wounds to feet, hands, neck, and areas like that that were not as severe as the ones I mentioned earlier, but all of whom needed operation.
Before UN forces took control of this former Yugoslavian army base, the warring factions planted an unknown number of minefields during their seesaw battles here. While many of the minefields lie waiting to be found, one way or another, many have been cordoned off by the UN forces.
You can see a lot of places in here that's been fenced in by barbed wire or some plastic tapes. And on this fences that you will find the different type of mines signs. Normally, the NATO used a triangular red one with the name mines on, and that's telling you that you have to stay out of these areas because these areas have been mined during the war or before UN came in here.
These French soldiers have already found several anti-personnel mines, which are designed more to seriously injure than to kill. Clearing this minefield is long, tedious, and potentially lethal work. Each man has to prod the ground at a 45-degree angle with his knife and carefully remove the foliage. It takes approximately 1 hour for an explosive ordnance team to clear 1 square meter.
You can find this mine under tripwire of another.
During
mine.
This briefing, members of a UN explosive ordnance team talk to Americans about the different type of landmines and how to avoid them as much as possible.
As with most people, after a month or so being here, you tend to get this false sense of security that everything's okay, no one's dying from the mines around here, but now I found out that they are present and the danger is still here.
Reporting for Navy and Marine Corps News, I'm Petty Officer Bill Polson. Multinational forces need to train together to be able to fight together. Without that training, joint operations, like we've seen in Croatia, Somalia, and the Middle East, might be far less effective. Well, U.S. Marines and Australian soldiers recently trained together in Hawaii for Golden Eagle 94. Petty Officer Brian Kaiser explains.
During their month-long exercise in Hawaii, the soldiers from the Royal Australian Regiment concentrated on amphibious training. Everything from helocasting to working with the amphibious assault vehicles.
Its reverse speed, fastest is 12 miles per hour. In the water, it can go about 8 knots.
The Australians have their own type of amphibious assault vehicle, but it's a little smaller than the one the Marines use.
It's good to work with this sort of stuff.
it's pretty cramped in the back though, you know. We don't fit as many blokes in, there's more room, but I don't know, it's always good to drive around in one. I'd rather be in one of these than walking everywhere.
Although there are differences in the way the two forces train, their missions are similar.
We're a part of what's termed the operational deployment force. We're a first-in element for our defence force, much the same role that the United States Marine Corps has.
While the Australians were training in Hawaii, a group of Marines from Kaneohe Bay were in Australia. Commanders have understood the value of joint training for years. Today, even the youngest Marines see why it's important.
If we ever have to link up with them for any reason, or for any reason we have to work with them, let them in our ranks. They have to know what we're doing, we have to know what they're doing.
But the training goes beyond what's done in the field.
One of the big objectives for Gold Eagle is to go home with a new array of experiences. And that doesn't necessarily mean jumping in and out of trucks, firing weapons. It means meeting people of different nations.
It was easy to see that during this short exercise, a strong bond developed.
They're great people. If they worked with us and I had to go to combat with them, I'd land on the line for them because they do the same for us.
Petty Officer Brian Kaiser, Kaneohe Marine Corps Base, Hawaii.
Now, when you hear the phrase high-tech Navy, it usually brings to mind modern computers, weapons, and engineering systems. But it also describes a new state-of-the-art firefighting trainer for submarine sailors in Washington State. Petty Officer Ron Flanders explains.
The alarm has been sounded, and members of this USS Florida fire party hurry to respond. Quartermaster Second Class Russell Mason and his mates quickly don their firefighting gear and rush to battle the blaze. Well, actually, it's not a real shipboard fire, but to the sailors who are fighting it, it's just as hot, just as potentially dangerous, and just as important to extinguish.
A submariner's worst nightmare is a fire. And that's why the high technology here at the Trident Training Facility firefighting trainer in Bangor is so important. Because when you're underway and submerged on one of these nuclear-powered submarines, there's no place to run.
On board a submarine, this is very realistic, very realistic. This will give you the visual effect, the heat effect, it'll give personnel effect. I mean, it really affects a lot of people on how they'll fight a fire.
Lead IOS, compartment temperature is 102.
The firefighting trainer's environment is monitored by instructors whose job is to use high-tech equipment to ensure training is as safe, environmentally sound, and as realistic as possible.
We can't really simulate a fire on board a submarine very well. This is good training to get in there, and you actually got the flames. You can see what you're doing with the fire hose.
Trident missile submarines are not only of vital importance to our nation's security, they cost billions of dollars. But a price cannot be put on the lives of these dynamic sailors, sailors who, after visiting the Trident Training Center firefighting trainer, can now double as firemen. Petty Officer Ron Flanders, Naval Submarine Base, Bangor, Washington.
When we come back, a family support team offers a helping hand to Navy parents.
And a sailor in Yokosuka teaches his shipmates the fine art of sailing. Stay with us.
During the summer of 1943, Allied forces launched the invasion of Sicily. Under the overall command of General Dwight D. Eisenhower, the invasion was codenamed Operation Husky. 38 days after the invasion began, more than 125,000 prisoners had been captured, and Sicily was secure. The fall of Sicily led to the collapse of Mussolini's fascist government and paved the way for the invasion of Italy. I'm Charlton Heston. A grateful nation remembers.
Welcome back. Being the parent of a new baby isn't easy. It takes a lot of time, energy, and patience. But it can be even tougher for military parents, especially when mom or dad is sent away on deployment.
And with nearly half of all Navy ships deployed right now, you should know that there's help available for military parents who need to balance both parenthood and a career. Petty Officer Diane Jacobs explains.
Like most sailors, Petty Officer Gehi works long hours. And then there's duty days and nights. But her job doesn't stop there. With husband David on sea duty, she faces another job when she gets home, being a parent of David, a premature baby who's lucky just to be alive.
The social worker came to my bedside the day I got the news of how my baby was doing, which was pretty bad news. And I had about a 4-hour life expectancy for him. And she was there at the door, waiting to come in to soothe and comfort me.
That social worker is a member of the Navy's parent support team. This team identifies people who may have a tough time being new parents.
It's a high-cost area, and they're uprooted, they're displaced, and now they've had the greatest stressor of all. They've added a new baby to their family.
The team steps in to help parents adjust. They help parents get the resources they need, whether it's an oxygen tank for a premature baby or just a ride to the doctor's office. And sometimes they just answer questions.
And I'd ask them different things about how much should he be eating, how do I know when he's full, how many times should he burp. I knew absolutely nothing. You would think I had never seen a baby before, and I've babysat pretty much all my life.
For Monica Gilliand, whose husband Bradley has been deployed for more than 3 months, the parent support team is like family. They help her deal not only with the deployment, but a new baby and a hyperactive 3-year-old.
I thought I was the worst, you know, worst parent in the world, and they really showed me and helped me, you know, it's not you, it's not your parenting skills, it's not the social environment that you're in, but it's a genetic thing, and you're going to have to learn how to deal with that.
Monica has learned to deal with it. Part of the reason, the parent support team makes house calls.
They let me release my tensions and my fears and things like that, which helps me because that keeps me from taking it out on my other children.
Since this program initially came out of and was identified as a child abuse prevention neglect program, families like this who are at a loss and under severe stressors, the parents are overwhelmed.
The parent support team makes home visits through the baby's first year, watching babies like David go from under 2 pounds to 21 pounds.
You're there to continuously see them grow, and then you see them at this point. I mean, it's just a wonderful feeling that you've done something to be able to help with this process.
It's during this process that parents like Gay and Monica learn that they can handle parenting in the Navy.
You do one thing at a time. You take one day at a time. And if it hadn't been for them, gosh, I don't know if I'd still be here. I'd probably be on a plane back to Texas.
Petty Officer Diane Jacobs, San Diego.
The parent support team in San Diego is one of just about a dozen teams the Navy and Marine Corps have scattered around the world, and participation in the program is strictly voluntary.
If you'd like to find out more about the program, contact the nearest Family Services Center.
Earlier in the show, you saw USS Normandy setting sail for D-Day celebrations in Europe. Well, another ship from a different kind of Navy set sail for Normandy recently. The SS Jeremiah O'Brien is the last active Liberty ship remaining from World War II. Army Sergeant Paul Stevenson reports.
The SS Jeremiah O'Brien is the only unaltered operational Liberty ship in the world today. As the ship passed through the canal, local residents were given the opportunity to visit the historic landmark. During her heyday, the O'Brien made 11 runs between Britain and Normandy, supporting landings, carrying troops, machinery, and supplies to Omaha and Utah beaches. A feat, given Liberty ships were built with a life expectancy of one voyage due to the high kill rates of enemy submarines.
I made 4 crossings of the Atlantic. It was a very lucky ship. We never saw torpedo wings, although we know that we had passed through submarine groups. It's the only one left of 2,750 that were built. The others have all been scrapped or sold or driving Toyotas or something like that today.
Now restored to its original condition, the O'Brien operates the same way it did over 50 years ago, even down to the ship's propulsion system.
The ships are designed actually to go about 10, 11 knots. That's about what they went during wartime conditions. This is what they call triple expansion steam engine. We use the steam 3 times, the same steam 3 times. We have a high pressure cylinder, a low pressure cylinder, and intermediate cylinder. We travel with 76 RPMs. That equates to about 12 knots, 11, 12 knots.
Passengers during the ship's transit of the canal had the opportunity to experience a bit of history aboard the O'Brien. Visitors were exposed to life aboard a World War II vessel. Everything from living conditions to how the ship protected herself while under attack. Everyone aboard was impressed with the restoration of the ship, as well as her crew.
Well, it's in remarkably good condition, and they've put a lot of time into getting the ship up to the point where it is now, and the men take a great deal of pride in what they've done, and rightfully so.
Oh, it's been awesome. Oh, the crew was really nice, willing to show us everything, do anything for us. It's a really unique way to transit the canal.
As the ship passed through the final lock and headed out to sea, the last ship of a day gone by leaves behind memories that will endure a lifetime. From the SS Jeremiah O'Brien, I'm Army Sergeant Paul Stevenson.
By the way, the Jeremiah O'Brien made it safely across the Atlantic to join in the D-Day commemoration activities.
I don't know about you, Herb, but I don't think spending my liberty time aboard a ship crossing the Atlantic with enemy subs lurking about is a way to relax.
Well, not then and definitely not now, and a lot of sailors can't wait to get as far away from the sea as possible when they pull back into port.
Well, not always. We found an exception to that. It's a sailor in Yokosuka, Japan, whose hobby is sailing. Petty Officer Tony Lopez reports.
Like all volunteers, Petty Officer Sean Ryan works around his busy duty schedule on board USS Kurtz.
Okay, now you've got all your sails, you've got your battens, you've got your jib sheets, your bow line. One other thing you're going to need.
Sean's been around boats all of his life because his father had sailboats. In 1978, when Sean was 9, his family made the front page of their local Paducah, Kentucky newspaper when they set sail for a year to visit Caribbean islands. Because of this lifelong regard for sailing, he wants to pass on the skill to others. He gets this opportunity to teach at the U.S. Naval Sailing Association, an MWR-sponsored four-day basic sailing class at Fleet Activities Yokosuka's Sailing Center.
The way that I learned to sail was from people who volunteered and donated their time to me. So it's not as much of an obligation to give that back to someone else as it is the enjoyment.
The tiller, the main sheet, and the jib sheet are just a few of the controls the sailors learn how to use in this basic sailing class.
Before I even signed up for the class, I've never even stepped on board a sailboat. But with Sean's patience and knowledge of the boat, he helped me learn all the equipment and pretty much gave me confidence to maneuver the boat on my own.
Well, it's nice to see students come in that, you know, some of them have never been in a boat before in their life, and after the 2-weekend class, seeing them come back and go out sailing by themselves, you get the feeling that you've actually done something worthwhile.
There's a hidden value to volunteering. For Petty Officer Ryan, the more volunteer instructors, the better. That will give him more time to freely enjoy his love for sailing. Petty Officer Tony Lopez, Yokosuka, Japan.
That's our show for this week. I'm Herb Josie.
And I'm Kathleen Booth. Before we go, here's a look at Armed Forces Day activities held at Andrews Air Force Base near Washington, D.C., produced by photographer's mate second class Andrea Moore.
Thanks for joining us. Have a great week.
As the team leader takes up a heading in this direction.
I'm Petty Officer Herb Josie.
And I'm Petty Officer Kathleen Booth. This week on Navy Marine Corps News, the hospital ship Comfort deploys for possible Haitian migrant processing.
Normandy vets set sail with USS George Washington for D-Day celebrations in Europe.
And American and Japanese sailors go head-to-head for some goodwill gold.
Join us along with Corporal Christiana Tigert for these stories and more on Navy Marine Corps News.
This week on Navy Marine Corps News, the hospital ship Comfort deploys for possible use in processing migrant Haitians. Normandy vets set sail with USS George Washington for D-Day celebrations in Europe. And American and Japanese sailors go head-to-head for some goodwill gold. I'm Petty Officer Kathleen Booth.
I'm Petty Officer Herb Josie.
And I'm Corporal Christiana Tigert. We'll have these stories and more next on Navy Marine Corps News. Welcome to Navy Marine Corps News. Last week, two Navy coastal patrol ships, the Cyclone and Tempest, got underway to support interdiction operations off the coast of Haiti. This week, another ship is en route to that region, the hospital ship Comfort.
Navy medical personnel on board the Comfort may be involved in processing migrant Haitians. We talked with some of the medical staff as they departed from the National Naval Medical Center in Bethesda, Maryland, to find out what they'll be doing.
They started loading the buses at sunrise. Then the 261 new USNS Comfort crew members said goodbye to their families and friends in Bethesda and hopped aboard the buses for a four-hour ride to Norfolk. There, they boarded what will probably be home for the next 6 months. Comfort's 1,000-bed capability may be used to support President Clinton's new plan to use ships at sea as processing centers for Haitians requesting asylum in the United States.
This is what I joined the Navy to do, help people, and that's what we're about to do.
It does make me feel real proud because we get to help more, you know, people that's less fortunate than we are. So I feel good about going. I really feel good about going.
But Comfort won't be just a processing center. The medical staff aboard may provide routine medical care to the Haitians.
Many of them are very, very sick and dehydrated, needed medical care, needed food, clothing, that kind of stuff.
Comfort's last call to active duty was during Operation Desert Storm in August 1990.
We hope to have more on Comfort's deployment in the upcoming weeks.
Thanks, Herb. And now Corporal Christiana Tigert joins us for a look at what's going on in other areas. Christiana?
Thanks, Kathleen. The March 94 advancement results are out, and the picture looks really good. Nearly 20,000 sailors have earned the opportunity to advance to their next pay grade. That's up from last September, and the numbers are expected to rise even more.
And we're projecting that advancement opportunity, for example, for E4 will go from 43%, which is what it was for this past cycle, to 45%. We're hoping to see the E5 advancement opportunity increase from the 11% that we had this cycle to 14%.
The Bureau of Naval Personnel is also projecting that advancements to E6 will rise from 7% to 10% during the next cycle in September. More than 800 midshipmen also saw their naval careers take a giant step forward.
During graduation ceremonies at the Naval Academy in Annapolis, President Clinton addressed the graduates. He told them of the importance of their career in a rapidly changing world.
I came here today because I want America to know there remains no finer Navy in the world than the United States Navy and no finer training ground for naval leadership than the United States Naval Academy.
Earlier the same week, the President also awarded posthumous medals of honor to two Army soldiers during a ceremony at the White House.
Great credit on him.
The Chief of Naval Operations attended the event and later reflected on the sacrifices that service members make while serving their country.
It puts into perspective what we do in the Navy when you see something like that. It puts into perspective the George Washington battle group sailing off to the Mediterranean and hopefully having a wonderful cruise where nobody shoots anybody, but always living with that potential that it could happen.
Here's a trivia question for you. What weighs 40 tons, is 23 feet wide, and is the largest of its kind on any U.S. Navy vessel?
Well, it's the new propeller on USS Supply.
It took San Diego divers almost 3 weeks to replace it. But they finished just in time because USS Supply departs for its new home port in Norfolk this summer. The Supply is the first of a new breed of fast combat support ships to have a propeller of this size.
Nearly 6,000 people laced up their jogging shoes recently for the 8th annual Over the Bay Bridge RunlWalk in San Diego.
The event was hosted by the Naval Base Morale, Welfare and Recreation Department. All proceeds will go to local recreation programs and the Navy Marine Corps Relief Society.
Oh, I think it's very important for Navy Relief and MWR because this benefits everyone in the Navy, not just any one person. And it gets everybody involved in a fitness state of mind, which is big in the Navy now.
And that's a look at this week's headlines. Herb, Kathleen.
Thanks, Christiana. After the CNO's recent trip to Norfolk, he found out one of the fleet's major concerns was access to their detailers in Washington. So we asked the Bureau of Naval Personnel to give us some tips for sailors who are trying to reach their detailers.
Detailers say the key to a successful call is doing your homework before you reach for the phone. Don't tie up the detailer asking questions you could have asked your command career counselor. And when you do make the call, be prepared to ask the right questions.
Also, remember to take advantage of night detailing. The second and fourth Wednesday of every month, detailers man the phones from 4 to 10 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Also, you can use BuPers Access to check out advancement results or even leave electronic mail for your detailer.
The BuPers officials say that some of their new initiatives have been quite successful. For example, the new callback program, where detailers actually return sailors' calls.
They've also given head-of-the-line privileges to sailors who were calling from overseas. According to the Navy's top detailer, that's just the beginning.
We've got a couple of more initiatives to try and help us get in contact with that person that's tried 14 or 15 times. One of the things we're doing is adding voicemail to all of our enlisted detailers' phones so that that person that wants to come in and leave a one-way message even to his detailer during off hours should be able to do that by the end of the summer. Another thing we're doing is for the person that doesn't have access to a computer and modem, we're going to add an interactive voice response just like your bank does so that anybody with an Audubon access to a phone can dial in and by selecting different numbers get the types of information that he needs off of BuPers Access without the use of a computer. So those are two additional things that are coming down the pike because we know we've got to do better.
All over the world, people are learning again about the sacrifices made by millions of young Americans who fought and died to preserve the freedom we enjoy today.
On this golden anniversary of D-Day, Petty Officer Bill Miles produced this story showing us the Normandy invasion through the eyes of those who were there.
Almighty God, our sons, pride of our nation, this day have set upon a mighty endeavor.
This is George Hicks speaking. I'm now speaking from the tower above the signal bridge of an American naval flagship, and we're lying some few miles off the coast of France, where the invasion of Europe has begun.
You have 4,100 ships crossing this relatively narrow channel. I was a young officer in B-17s, and we had a mission that day. And as we then saw through the clouds, those ships down there, it almost looked to us that you could jump from the deck of one ship to another from across the channel.
Now, we had 57 PT boats and 110 minesweepers. And the task was to sweep six lanes into Utah and Omaha Beach. So the follow-up with the Army coming aboard, about 320,000 soldiers, could get past the minefield without getting blown up and land those troops.
I would have died. I know I would have died if it wasn't for him. If he didn't push me, I knew I would have made it. But in the meantime, there was a couple other guys he took care of, too. He was the archangel or something out there. Or was it Raymer and Missioner? And they were wandering around. I guess they couldn't see where they were going. So he drug them in, too. And then we went about our business.
101st Airborne Division found out the corpsman had gotten appendicitis and couldn't go the last minute. I said, I'm going with you. He said, you want to go? I said, yeah. So he said, jump in the boat. I jumped in the boat. When that front door went down on that thing and opened that up and I saw those poor guys out there floating all around, some of those guys sunk right to the bottom. They never did come up.
Well, I'm proud that I participated in it. This is something now that I have to do in memory of the men, my friends who died. Well, you know, you figure what would have happened in if these people lived, what kind of life they would have had.
We'll be right back.
World War II raged for six long years. During the 50th anniversary of this war, we pause to remember and honor these uncommon patriots, both living and dead, their families, and those who served in the home front. I'm Charlton Heston. A grateful nation remembers.
Welcome back to Navy Marine Corps News. You know, Kathleen, when I was in Norfolk in the USS George Washington Joint Task Group deployed, I talked to a lot of sailors, and they seemed to be really excited about participating in the D-Day events.
Well, they have a lot to be excited about. Not only is this the first deployment for USS George Washington, but they also get to lead the Joint Task Group in retracing the path of Allied ships to Normandy 50 years ago.
We spoke with Admiral Borda, who's going to the Normandy ceremonies, recently about the significance of this historic event.
I tell you, I am really proud of, first of all, what people did at D-Day at Normandy and at the beaches and in the United Kingdom as the people came over. And I'm very proud of our Navy people who are helping celebrate and commemorate that event. I say commemorate really more than celebrate because an awful lot of people died there. And while we celebrate their sacrifice, we commemorate what they did. And what they did, it really changed the world. You and I are here talking today because of people like that. The George Washington Battle Group, many, many ships, lots and lots of sailors are over there showing our nation's gratitude for the men and women who gave their lives really for our freedom. You got to feel good about it.
And when the George Washington left Norfolk, it took several Normandy vets along for the ride.
But after Bob Kahn was aboard and has this report.
12 World War II veterans, six of which were either at Normandy or on ships off the coast, are sailing on board USS George Washington to take part in the 50th anniversary celebration. The veterans are sponsored on board by their sons or even their grandsons. They feel privileged to have the chance to be there for this special celebration.
To me, it's going to be just a great, glorious day, something that I look forward to.
For me, it's going to be a great honor. Because number one, my father will be there with me, but also it'll be a little sad for remembrance of the people who gave up their lives.
Gordon Hazel was a gunner on board the aircraft carrier USS Boxer in 1944. He says he's amazed at the abilities of the Navy's newest aircraft carrier.
When I walk up on the flight deck before I get a kick out of it, you used to see the guns on ours, and this here, they're missiles and stuff, you don't even notice them. You had 5-inch 38, you had 20 millimeters, you had blisters all along the side of the carrier I was on, 40 millimeters, and it's different, it's huge, it's hard to believe.
Walter Campbell, who served in the Pacific during World War II, says he's amazed at the sheer size of USS George Washington.
I can't even explain to you how big this ship is and how small the ship I was on. I think there are 6,000 people here, 25 on mine. Now you know the difference.
Crew members on board say they're excited to learn more about a war that most of them only know from history books.
I think it's a great honor that they will select our ship to be a part of a great ceremony like that, and I'm looking forward to it.
For the crew and these few World War II heroes, the memories of this great battle will live on in today's sailors for years to come. For Navy Marine Corps News, I'm Petty Officer Bob Kahn.
Well, Herb, I think the entire world's attention will be focused on Normandy this week, that's for sure.
Yes, it will. Next week, we'll focus and wrap up with a look at Navy involvement in the invasion.
Well, keep in mind the June edition of All Hands magazine is on the street, and it features the original articles printed in the magazine in July 1944 after the Allied invasion of Normandy.
Ooh. June's edition also profiles our new CNO, and it gives you some tips on how to keep your finances in order, so make sure you pick up a copy.
Well, Herb, back in 1944, Allied soldiers hit the beaches of Normandy in small personnel craft that cruised at about 10 knots.
Very slow. Well, times have changed, and so has the transportation. Petty Officer Brian Wood tells us how modern-day boat coxswains learn how to reach the beach without getting wet.
If you think driving a car or truck over rough roads is a tough way to make a living, try driving a 300,000-pound vehicle that flies 4 feet above water or rough terrain. This monster of a vehicle is the Landing Craft Air Cushion Hovercraft, or LCAC, and learning to fly it takes a lot of training.
The LCACs, when we're training crews, go out 3 days a week, generally, five-hour missions per training crew. Proficiency time, we have to maintain 80 hours a year to stay proficient.
Hovercraft training for transporting tanks, armored vehicles, and personnel can cost as much as $300,000 an hour. But now there's a cheaper way to train. The Navy, in conjunction with Hughes Training Incorporated, has designed and developed an LCAC training simulator.
I would think that the biggest thing we've brought to the training community is going to be flexibility in their training curriculum. Instead of having to get a boat started, underway, spend 2 hours transiting open water to go out and perform a well deck entry, we can initialize a trainer 500 yards astern of the support ship, and we can spend a three-hour block of training doing nothing but well deck entries or casualty control.
It's almost like virtual reality. You have these screens that are surrounding you and almost what's called sensoround. We're inside the simulator for an LCAC, and we're right now at Sea State 3. So let's go along for the ride.
This is a computer-controlled system, like a huge video game, operated from a control room. A hydraulic system can simulate rough water up to 12 feet. Crew members can practice handling 250 emergency situations, plus embarking and debarking a ship.
You can do some awesome things with this trainer. You can duplicate any navigation casualty that you're going to have out in the fleet on the real LCACs. If you do have casualty, you can correct it instantaneously. And I can see where it would be a real benefit as far as learning casualty procedures, practicing to get hands-on. I mean, they're real similar, but there are a few differences here and there.
The job of flying LCACs is left up to senior enlisted crew members who have a responsibility few experience.
When you can come through 8 months and then actually have a craft given to you that's worth $22 million, and you basically own it, you take all the heat, all the glory, everything for it, that's an outstanding feeling.
Reporting for Navy Marine Corps News, I'm Petty Officer Brian Wood, Norfolk.
I want to fly like an eagle.
Herb, I think I need to get an LCAC myself to drive around D.C. I mean, they can't mess with you then,
not
right?
Not at all. You just push them out of the way, you know, or you can just zoom over them, pass them. I don't know.
Truckers, watch out. Definitely. That's what I have to say.
Seriously.
When we come back, we're going to show you one of the most appetizing jobs in the Navy.
And Japanese and American sailors go head-to-head for some Goodwill gold. Stay with us.
If anyone ever tells you that you ask too many questions, that your thoughts aren't important, or you're trying too hard, if they say you should never stand out, get involved, stick up for what you believe, and if they tell you that you think too much, or that you dream too much, truth, if anyone ever tells you you're too much anything, or not enough anything, well, what they think means nothing.
A message from the U.S. Navy, where we believe the only way to grow is to rise to the challenge.
You're working hard to reach your dreams, saving what you can each day. Be smart about how you do it. Make sure you save the safest way. Buy bonds, U.S. savings bonds. Guaranteed returns mean you can't go wrong. They're just as safe as a Monday is long. So happen starting right now. You can reach all your dreams. It's not hard when you know how. Buy bonds, U.S. savings bonds. Buy
Welcome back. Every year, the Navy salutes the best food service in the fleet with its Captain Ney Memorial Awards. But who picks the winners, and how do they do it? Petty Officer Diane Jacobs has the answers.
The cooks and food service attendants on the USS Essex take great pride in their mess decks. They work hard year-round to cook delicious food and keep the mess deck spotless. But today, they're applying a little bit of extra elbow grease because they're under the microscope of a Ney inspection team.
The guys that I work with, I'm trying to get them to pay attention to detail, make sure everything's spotless, everything's on time.
If they're doing it right every day, we can tell that just in the short time that we're on board.
Senior Chief Rick Patton is one of four members of this inspection team, and they're looking for a lot more than just good food.
Cleanliness is probably the most important. If it's clean, and then the second thing is well-prepared food, that's a big morale booster for the crew.
Senior Chief Patton judges the safety of the cooking equipment and scrutinizes the financial records. It's his job to make sure what was recorded as being served every day matches up with what was taken out of the storeroom.
You know, some days they might be over, but some days they might be under that figure. So as long as it balances itself out.
With so many facilities in competition for the Ney Award, Senior Chief and the other team members say the tough part is keeping the 20 finalists from blurring into one another.
You have to look at each one differently. You have to look at their capabilities and just what they can do with what they have to work with.
A mess management specialist himself, Senior Chief Patton, remembers the days when he was being judged.
It's totally different because now, instead of being the nervous one trying to make sure everything's right, I'm here to check to make sure that they're doing things properly.
Well, the cooks on the Essex believe they've got the recipe for success.
A lot of effort, a lot of overtime, but you have to put in overtime to be the best, you know. That's all we're trying to do.
We're hoping to be perfect on everything. It's stressing, but we're trying to make it to be perfect teamwork. Teamwork is what makes a perfect crew.
The mess crew will have to wait a couple of months for the judge's decision. In the meantime, the inspection team will pack up their bags and continue the search for the best food service in the fleet. Petty Officer Diane Jacobs, San Diego.
You know, Herb, I don't know, I'd hate to be judged on my cooking. I promised my husband for a New Year's resolution that I'd learn to cook. So far, I think I've mastered TV dinners.
Ooh, heavy use of the microwave,
yep.
I'll bet. Well, speaking of TV, the game show Wheel of Fortune, they're going to be taping 10 shows aboard a Norfolk-based aircraft carrier this fall.
Right, and as Petty Officer Dave Smith tells us, it's not as easy as it looks to get on one of those shows.
Easy money, free gifts, and the excitement of playing the game. That's what these hopeful Wheel of Fortune contestants are competing for. The contestant search was conducted for military personnel at Norfolk's Marriott Hotel.
Well, we've already selected our civilian contestants. In this interview, we're going to have all armed services personnel, and we're going to probably try and get a good number. I don't exactly know how. It's hard to tell because you have to pass the test first.
A test to spin the Wheel of Fortune?
Well, it's just basically a word puzzle test that there's 16 puzzles and you have 5 minutes to do the test. And you got to get more than half to pass. And that's the first cut that we make.
And you wouldn't think it would take a lot of skill to guess a word, but when you turn on the stage lights and cameras, well, it becomes a matter of nervous energy and luck.
It takes more skills than people realize, because when you're at home and you're all relaxed and you can look at the puzzle and it's always your turn.
Okay, we get the picture. Those that don't pass the test are cut from the competition. Those that do get to play practice rounds of Wheel of Fortune. So let's go to the experts and see just how difficult this test is.
No, I didn't complete the whole thing. I got around to it, but the time was pretty fast. I mean, when they said 1 minute, I was like, oh my goodness, but I think I did fairly well.
Well, he didn't make it to the practice rounds.
This way you have to fill in all the letters, and that's kind of difficult because you have no clues.
She didn't qualify either.
Average, fair. Did as good as I could be expected to do.
And neither did he. Yep, it's harder than it looks. But everybody was given the opportunity to leave as a winner in the end. Door prize ticket numbers were called out.
7, 6, 4, 5, 7, 9.
Woo!
And various prizes given away. Then it was time for the 27 remaining hopefuls to play the practice games.
when they were getting down to the end and they were calling people, I thought, oh, well, it was fun. It was good to be here. I was already going home.
But she made it to the practice rounds. Unfortunately, the final contestants won't be notified until later.
They'll know within 2 to 3 weeks when we send them a letter that says, congratulations, you've made it. And we only notify those who've made it.
And how many contestants will be the lucky ones notified?
We hope to get, I would say, at least 10.
One thing's for sure, they had a lot of interesting personalities from which to choose. In Norfolk, I'm Petty Officer Dave Smith.
Boy, if Wheel of Fortune test is that hard, I don't even want to know what it's like to get on Jeopardy.
Oh, I'm sure you could make it. No problem.
Yeah, right. Well, some sailors in Japan had a chance to enter a different kind of competition recently.
That's right. Japanese and American sailors had a chance to go head-to-head in some friendly Olympic-type contests. Petty Officer Tony Lopez has more.
And the games began, not games of cutthroat competition, but of Navy volunteers out for a day with their Japanese counterparts.
I think it's, you know, a good thing to get the, you know, to get the Americans and the Japanese together and, you know, competitive sports like this, you know, when sportsmanship plays a very good part and, you know, we both show very good sportsmanship.
The Friendship Olympics consists of 9 events, including tug-of-war and various swimming and running events at American and Japanese installations in Yokosuka.
I think the American sportsmanship is a lot like the Japanese. They are very friendly.
At the beginning of the 7th annual Friendship Olympics, Americans and Japanese were tied at 3 wins apiece.
Last year we won the Olympics, and this year it seemed like they brought in some ringers, and it was very competitive this year, very competitive.
By the end of the day, the JMSDF team had edged the USN team by winning 5 of the 9 events. Perhaps next year the USN team can even the score. Petty Officer Tony Lopez, Yokosuka, Japan.
That's our show for this week. I'm Herb Josie.
And I'm Kathleen Booth. Before we go, if you have a story idea or a comment about the show, call the Navy Marine Corps News Hotline at 202-433-6108 or DSN 288-6108.
You'll get an answering machine, but please leave a message. We do listen to each and every one. Thanks for joining us, and we'll see you next week.
I'm Petty Officer Kathleen Booth.
And I'm Petty Officer Herb Josie. This week on Navy Marine Corps News, President Clinton commemorates the Allied invasion of Normandy during D-Day ceremonies on board USS George Washington.
Hometowns across America pay tribute to D-Day vets here in the States.
And a sailor in California pulls double duty on the streets of Burbank.
Join us along with Corporal Christiana Tigard for these stories and more on Navy Marine Corps News.
This week on Navy Marine Corps News, President Clinton commemorates the Allied invasion of Normandy during D-Day ceremonies on board USS George Washington. Hometowns across America pay tribute to D-Day vets here in the States, and a sailor in California pulls double duty on the streets of Burbank. I'm Petty Officer Herb Josie.
I'm Petty Officer Kathleen Booth.
And I'm Corporal Christiana Tigert. We'll have these stories and more next on Navy Marine Corps News.
Welcome to Navy Marine Corps News. President Bill Clinton was on board the Navy's newest aircraft carrier this week, USS George Washington, to commemorate the 50th anniversary of the Allied invasion of Normandy.
The GW task group, along with ships from other countries, crossed the English Channel, retracing the path Allied ships took 50 years ago to mark the beginning of the end of World War II. The last notes of taps have faded into the Normandy countryside. The last wreath tossed into the English Channel to honor those who died so that freedom might live. And after hosting the President and D-Day veterans, sailors on ships in the George Washington Joint Task Group can now think back on D-Day and understand why, 50 years after the invasion of Normandy, the past echoes in missions of the present.
The ultimate lesson of D-Day is that we never forgot that we had to stay strong in defense of freedom. Because the members of the armed services today have stayed in our armed services and have kept us strong, the best trained, the best prepared, the highest morale armed forces in the world, we've never had to have another D-Day.
Today, we honor them. They made the ultimate sacrifice then, so we can be free now.
And the significance of taking part in the D-Day commemorations wasn't lost on today's sailor.
We have great respect for the people that did do the job over here, and that's what it's all about, is remembering them and the job they did, the sacrifice they made.
We need to be proud of those people. We need to honor them, and we need to learn from their sacrifice so we don't have to make it again.
The task group began their D-Day activities on the English side of the channel, then crossed for France D-Day morning, retracing the path the 5,000-ship invasion fleet took to Normandy 50 years ago. President Clinton rode USS George Washington across the channel to the ceremonies in Normandy.
One of the most stirring tales of D-Day is that to which the Secretary of the Navy has already referred, the tale of the USS Cory, ripped by mines while blasting enemy positions on Utah Beach. The Cory began to go under, but one man stayed aboard. He climbed the stern, removed the flag, and swam and scrambled to the main mast. There he ran up the flag, and as he swam off, our flag opened into the breeze. In the Cory's destruction, there was no defeat. Today, the wreckage of that ship lies directly beneath us, an unseen monument to those who helped to win this great war. 13 of the Cory's crew rest there as well, and these waters are forever sanctified by their sacrifice. 50 years ago, General Eisenhower concluded his order of the day with these words: "Let us all beseech the blessing of Almighty God upon this great and noble undertaking." As we begin this new day of remembrance, let us also ask God's blessing for all those who died for freedom 50 years ago, and for the Americans who carry on their noble work today. May God bless them, and may God bless America.
During the D-Day ceremonies, the task group lined up before the beaches, like their predecessors did 50 years ago,
in a silent tribute to the sacrifice made by those 9,000 Americans buried on bluffs overlooking these beaches.
After the D-Day ceremonies, our Petty Officer Bill Polson caught up with President Clinton and asked him his thoughts on the events of D-Day.
Well, many thoughts. In Italy, I thought a lot about my own father, who was in the army in Italy in the Italian campaign. I thought about how many of our members of the armed forces who never thought their efforts there were sufficiently recognized, so I was glad we could do it. In England, I thought about how long the air war went on before D-Day. And of course, here in France, I thought about how the whole world was changed by the sacrifices, the incredible sacrifices made by the people who were part of D-Day. I don't think any American could see this without a sense of pride that our country, without our very existence being threatened, but with our way of life being trampled in Europe and in Asia, went into World War II and literally saved our way of life.
Sir, sailors will be curious about how you spent your night on board the George Washington.
Oh, I loved it. I loved it. When I got to the George Washington, I first met with a good portion of the crew, and then I was, along with Admiral Border, got to preside over a re-enlistment ceremony, and then I toured a good deal of the carrier. Then we had dinner, and I went over my speeches for today, and then I got up real early this morning and went out and toured a little more of the carrier. I went up on the deck this morning, and I wanted to jog on the deck, but I got there at about 6:30, and there were already helicopters landing. I will say this, I slept as soundly on the George Washington as I've ever slept on land.
Sir, before we wrap up, do you have anything like that at all?
Just a simple thank you to all the men and women of the armed forces, and especially to the 2,700 men and women in uniform who helped make this D-Day celebration possible. They put on 52 events in the last 2 days alone, and I don't think they will ever know what they did for the tens of thousands of veterans who were here and the many thousands more who couldn't come but who watched on television. They did our country proud.
Kathleen, it was really great of the president to take the time to talk to Petty Officer Polson about the Navy.
Absolutely. You know that the president probably conducted hundreds of interviews over the last couple days, so it's good that he actually talked to Navy Marine Corps News. It's pretty impressive.
Mm-hmm. Well, let's take a look at what's happening around the fleet with Corporal Christiana Tigert.
Christiana?
Thanks, Kathleen. The economy may be on the rise, but your variable housing allowance may not be, unless you complete the newest VHA survey. Each year, the Bureau of Naval Personnel surveys the fleet to get the latest information on the cost of housing. The survey takes only minutes to complete, but it can improve your quality of life for years to come.
It's a very simple form. It only takes 10 minutes. The sooner they get it done, the better off they are. And what it does is, if you're in a high-cost area, it gives you a higher VHA rate.
These surveys are not only important to you, but to your shipmates, too. Chief of Naval Operations Admiral Mike Borda says it's worth the effort you put into it.
I can't tell you how important those surveys are, that they be done well and that you really list all the costs. The idea is not to cheat and get more money for people than is legally appropriate, but we want to get every single penny for people that is legally proper. And that means you have to do a little bit of work when you fill out those surveys. So please do that, and please include everything. The idea is to pay you more money, not less, right up to the maximum.
And remember, if you get a survey, please complete it, because next year's VHA rates depend on your input. In other quality of life news, Navy housing in Pearl Harbor is getting a facelift. The Navy's renovating more than 100 family housing units at a cost of about $25,000 per unit. Secretary of the Navy John Dalton says this is one example of how Navy leadership is committed to improving quality of life for today's sailors and Marines.
And there was a suggestion that the funds for housing be reduced, and we put those dollars right back in there. As a matter of fact, enhance the dollars that would be available for rehabilitation of housing and new construction of housing.
And finally, the Marine Corps has awarded the Bronze Star to Staff Sergeant Darren Nicholson for saving the life of a fellow Marine. Staff Sergeant Nicholson was driving across Mogadishu, Somalia, when his Humvee hit a landmine. The explosion threw all but one of the passengers from the vehicle.
I don't remember hitting the ground. I just remember jumping up. And dirt, debris, rocks, vehicle parts, weapons parts, ammunition, everything was still hitting the ground, falling, you know, landing. And that's when the rounds broke out. They started shooting at us.
But instead of running for cover, Nicholson ran back to the vehicle to help a Marine who was trapped under the engine. He stayed with the wounded Marine through intense gunfire until help arrived. After he received the Bronze Star, Nicholson said, quote, "It was okay for me to die, but whatever happened, I would not leave the injured Marine." And that's a look at this week's headlines. Kathleen, Herb.
Thanks, Christiana. When a boiler exploded on board an Egyptian passenger ferry in the Northern Red Sea recently, nearby vessels, including three U.S. Navy ships, responded to the distress call.
The destroyer Briscoe, frigate Stephen W. Groves, and the supply ship Henry J. Kaiser helped rescue hundreds of ferry passengers and crew members trapped by the blaze.
The sailors maneuvered small boats alongside the burning ferry to rescue people as they climbed down ropes or as they made the 30 to 40 foot jump from the ship's stern.
This one woman had a baby. We think the baby was 12 hours old, a very, very tiny baby. She didn't know what to do with this. She handed this baby off to a man who dropped it to our waiting boat. And one of my men, SM1 Griffin, actually caught this baby, and the baby was unharmed.
When I got up to it, I couldn't believe it. I couldn't believe that a ship was burning like that. And we saw the people, they saw us, and panic just erupted. Everybody started jumping into the water. It was trying to swim to us. We took as many as we could the first time, got back to one of the tugboats, dropped them off, went back to pick up some more. I think it was the second trip with the baby.
Navy helicopters helped find survivors in the water, and medical teams on board the Henry J. Kaiser treated more than 250 injured people. 13 hours after the ferry started burning, it sank. Navy ships, along with several other merchant ships and tugs, saved more than 500 of the nearly 600 people aboard the ferry.
Can you believe that, Herb? The guy caught a baby that's being dropped from like 30 to 40 feet.
That's
no
amazing.
Way.
Whoa, he must have been a football player or something
right,
in high school.
That must have been it. When we come back, people across America commemorate D-Day here in the U.S.
And over in Japan, the city of Shimoda remembers Commodore Perry's Black Ship Fleet. Stay with us.
During the 50th anniversary of World War II, we pause to remember and honor these uncommon patriots, their families, and those who served in the home front. I'm Charlton Heston. A grateful nation remembers.
Welcome back to Navy Marine Corps News. While the world focused its attention on D-Day commemorations in France and England, hometowns across America also paid tribute to the veterans. Petty Officer Bill Miles reports.
Not every Normandy veteran could be in Europe on the 50th anniversary of D-Day, so towns and cities across America made sure the veterans who stayed behind weren't forgotten. One of those towns was Santa Monica, California, where ceremonies included the frigates USS Copeland and a French Navy ship. U.S. and French sailors watched as Normandy veterans hit the beach and vintage World War II aircraft flew overhead.
This is wonderful because this whole thing is, even though the men are not here, they see it, and it makes me feel good. That's why I go to Memorial Day and my family, and we video things, and we don't forget.
Chicago was another city that remembered.
On June 6, 1944, was a day of danger and daring, of sacrifice and loss, of heroism and hope. The course of history was changed and democracy was preserved. And today, we in Chicago pay tribute to those heroes.
And they did that with the reenactment of D-Day on the beaches of Lake Michigan. What seemed like the set for a World War II movie was actually a reenactment at Fort Story on Virginia Beach. Naval Amphibious Base Little Creek provided the landing craft and SEALs to help with the pyrotechnics.
Well, I tell you, I'm very honored to be doing this. I'm third generation Navy. My grandfather was a warrant officer. My dad's a chief who is still in. So I was very honored to be chosen to do this. I was real hyped. I was having a good time out there.
More than 1,000 people took part in this reenactment that took 2.5 years to plan. And the planning paid off. More than 10,000 spectators, including dozens of World War II veterans, watched the drama unfold.
It's nice to see that a lot of people haven't forgotten. Those that, you know, didn't really know about it came out to see what it was all about. You know, it's nice to see people take pride in their country.
From California to Chicago to Virginia, all across this country and Europe, people remember those who fought and those who gave their lives for freedom. For Navy Marine Corps News, I'm Petty Officer Bill Miles.
Thanks, Bill. You know, Herb, we tend to think of our Navy today as being global, but it's really been a global force for a long time. For example, before Commodore Matthew Perry's Black Ship fleet visited Japan in 1854, Japan's doors were closed to the world for some 200 years.
Oh, but now Japan celebrates Commodore Perry's landing each year with a Black Ship Festival. Petty Officer Tony Lopez covered this year's event, but first, here's a pop quiz. We asked sailors stationed in Yokosuka how much they really knew about this chapter in naval history.
Well, I know that it's that he was the man that opened up trade or opened up Japan to the Western world.
A lot of company commanders talked about him in boot camp, but you never really got into it until you got over here.
I've learned about him from a movie just recently called Shogun.
Well, whether some sailors are history buffs or not, Commodore Perry's visit is remembered annually in the place it happened, in Shimoda.
The crew of USS Rodney M. Davis dropped anchor in Shimoda Bay, much like Commodore Matthew Perry's Black Ship Squadron did more than a century ago. It was in 1854 that Commodore Perry and four U.S. Navy ships faced quite a challenging mission to convince Japan to open its long-closed doors to America and the world. Today, American and Japanese navies and citizens commemorate that historical event with parades and ceremonies.
I think it's a great idea. The people here are really friendly, and they seem to enjoy having us down here for the festival.
One of the highlights of the Black Ship Festival is the reenactment of the signing of the peace treaty by Commodore Perry's party and Japanese officials in Shimoda.
It brought upon that realism, you know, of like you were right there. It's about as close as we're going to get.
The realism of Commodore Perry's mission accomplishment is evident every day in Shimoda, and maybe being this close will help bring history alive for people who've only read about it in books. Petty Officer Tony Lopez, Shimoda, Japan.
Navy Marine Corps News will be right back.
Stay with us.
Prevention is the best firefighter.
Welcome back. Sailors and Marines descended on the Big Apple over the past week for Fleet Week 94. Now, you may recognize this next face. It's our former shipmate on Navy Marine Corps News, Petty Officer Quinn Litton. He's here to tell us New York City rolled out the red carpet of hospitality to its seafaring visitors.
Welcome to New York City's Fleet Week 94. This is a time the city sets aside each year to say thanks to the sailors and Marines who contribute to our nation's defense, both on land and at sea, at home and abroad.
Seven U.S. Navy ships, along with four U.S. Coast Guard ships and vessels from Brazil, Mexico, and Bermuda, joined forces for this year's 7th annual Fleet Week.
There, see, he's waving.
Several displays were set up to show visitors up close some of the equipment sailors and Marines use to do their jobs. These seals held the attraction of many passers-by with their mobile underwater exhibit.
New York opens its arms to us just like any other community would, and the more people see what we do and how we spend their money, I think maybe in the long run, the more support we may get, you know, not only from our legislators, but from the people themselves.
Over on the USS Kearsarge, this robot held a fascination for one adventurous kid. Sailors and Marines, while guests this week, had no problem answering questions and giving tours to show taxpayers just how their dollars are being spent.
They see what we have, and that way other people see what we have, and they want to join the military too.
Let the public know that we are here for them, and we are defending their country.
For many visitors, this was their first tangible exposure to the Navy. Fleet Week 94 gave many the opportunity to understand what it takes to run a Navy and why it's important to have one.
Welcome to Fleet Week, all you sailors.
Sailors and Marines took advantage of their VIP status during their stay and kept busy taking in all they could.
Sightseeing, going to the observatory over there at Trade Center, and went to MC Studios, and went to Yankee game last night, first Yankee game been to.
Back on the flight deck of the Intrepid Museum, sailors from USS O'Bannon took on Camp Lejeune Marines in a friendly competition of volleyball. Volleyball, soccer, and a 4K run were just some of the events personnel from all the visiting ships had a chance to compete in during this year's Fleet Week. There were also parties for the crew. Free food and drink were plentiful for those building up an appetite and thirst from working out on the dance floor. The guests of honor said they appreciated what the city had done to say thanks for their hard work and sacrifices.
We've been doing a lot of displays for the civilians, retired veterans. I was on a 21-gun salute squad this afternoon. It's been an exciting week so far, and I'm looking forward to spending a lot more time in New York City.
The sailors and Marines we've spoken with all agree that they had a great time here, not only showing off themselves, but their ships and hardware, and helping their hosts better understand the Navy's From the Sea doctrine. Reporting from New York City at Fleet Week 94, I'm Petty Officer Quinn Linton.
Thanks, Quinn. Many sailors think that the Navy Memorial here in Washington honors sailors who gave their lives defending America's freedom, and it does. But as Petty Officer Mark Kane tells us, the Navy Memorial is also for you.
On October 13, 1987, the lone sailor began his never-ending watch over the Navy Memorial. He represents every sailor that has ever been or will ever be in the Navy. He stands with pride, immovable, inspiring all generations. The Navy Memorial is a place every sailor can call home.
Well, I'd like to say to all those young sailors out there on those ships, and offshore sailors also, that you do have, if you're aboard a ship, you do have a home port, but we would like for you to think of your Navy Memorial as your second home port.
And that's exactly how our Chief of Naval Operations felt.
When you're not flying anybody else's flag there, how about flying mine all the time and let this be my home port?
Now his flag sails high above his new home port. You can be a part of that too by joining the Navy Memorial Log. It's an interactive computer that lets people view the photograph and history of anyone that's been entered. But don't worry, you don't have to be history to become part of it.
About 80% of the people that are registered in the Navy Memorial Log are alive and kicking, and a lot of them are on active duty.
Call 1-800-NAVY-LOG to get this brochure. It contains a form that lists all the information needed for your log entry. Each entry costs $25, $50 if you include a photo.
Who's that young fellow?
Got me.
Bernard Clary spent more than 40 years in the Navy, and for the first time, he and his wife were able to spend part of their vacation visiting the Navy Memorial.
Anyone who's proud of being in the Navy should make it a point to get his picture and his name and something about him in this memorial. It's here for that purpose.
Once your log entry is complete, keep in mind you don't have to be here to see it. In fact, to have a copy, it's just a phone call away. That same 800-NAVY-LOG number can get you a photocopy of your entry once it's in the log. So if you're able to visit the Navy Memorial in person, or even if you can't, just remember for whom the lone sailor stands.
Once a young sailor gets here and look at the memorial and get a feel for the memorial, they get a greater appreciation for it. And they'll realize that this memorial is not just dedicated to World War II veterans or Civil War veterans, but it's also dedicated to them.
Petty Officer Mark Kane, Washington.
There's a sailor stationed in California who spends his daytime hours recruiting young men and women to help fill the Navy's ranks. But when he's off duty, the Burbank Police Department recruits him to help protect the community. Petty Officer Ron Flanders has the story.
As any recruiter will tell you, doing their job anywhere USA is not easy. But Petty Officer Brandon Ward has a slightly different perspective. Because when he's not bringing people into the Navy, he's got his hands full bringing down criminals as a member of the Burbank Police Department.
The police is paramilitary anyways. That really helped out a lot, especially through the police academy. The leadership qualities that you learn from the Navy. The Navy teaches you, makes you a lot more mature. We do follow instructions, and that is a must. We follow rules and regulations every day in the Navy. People out in civilian life, they don't have to do that.
459, which is an auto burglary.
We got two white male subjects that broke into this unfortunate lady's car and took something. We're going to go investigate.
Bad boys, what you going to do?
Yeah, behind your back. Behind your back. Palms together. Palms together. Interlace your fingers. Interlace just like that. Spread your legs. Okay. Got anything on you? Any needles? Anything like that? Put that cigarette out for me. You didn't ask me if you could smoke. Sit down. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you inside the jacket what one of the subjects had. Nice little needle.
You took the ASVAB, correct? Did you get on the ASVAB?
Petty Officer Ward is considered a model sailor and consistently meets all recruiting goals. He was recently capped a first-class petty officer, and according to his fellow cops on the force, Officer Ward is a pretty straight shooter as well.
There's probably no better reserve in the department. He's dependable. He's been in situations with not just myself but other officers where our lives have been on a line, and he's been there to back us up.
223 South.
Petty Officer Ward patrols the street 8 hours a night for as many as four nights a week, often putting himself in harm's way. But believe it or not, since he's a reserve officer on the force, he does this dangerous work for only a buck a year.
I love the job. I mean, it's great. It's, you know, it's something I can put back into the community. It's a positive image for the Navy, and I love it.
Sleep well, Burbank. Brandon Ward is on the job. Reporting for Navy Marine Corps News, I'm Petty Officer Ron Flanders.
Well, that's going to wrap up our show for this week, but before we go, over the last 2 weeks we've shown you some of the D-Day celebrations around the globe commemorating veteran service in Normandy back in 1944.
Well, we'll leave you now with a look at what sailors and Marines are doing in 1994, sent to us by the Far East Network in Okinawa, Japan. That's our show for this week. I'm Herb Josie.
And I'm Kathleen Booth. We'll see you next week.
I could not foresee this thing happening to you.